Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome our next speaker, Mrs. Anjali Mukhija, President Consultant at Secma Consultancy Private Limited.
I would like to call upon Dr. Archana Srivastava, Director in Charge, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to welcome Mrs. Anjali Mukhija with a bouquet.
Thank you, ma'am. May we now call upon Chaitanya Gaikwad, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, to introduce Mrs. Anjali Mukhija.
A very good morning to one and all present. I have the honor of introducing our guest speaker for this session, Mrs. Anjali Mukhija. Anjali ma'am is a risk and compliance financial services professional, largely in capital markets. Ma'am has over 20 years of rich experience in risk management, compliance, legal, client relations, and dispute grievance redressal, coupled with public dealings. Ma'am has extensive experience in the area of customer services, investor awareness, and education. Ma'am is instrumental in setting up the Delhi Regional Office of National Stock Exchange. Ma'am is President Consultant at Secma Consultancy Private Limited. Prior to joining Secma, ma'am was Head SVP Risk and Compliance at Fullerton Securities and Wealth Advisors Limited. Before Fullerton, she was Vice President Compliance and Operations at Unicorn Financial Intermediaries Private Limited. Ma'am is a postgraduate in Mathematics from University of Delhi. Ma'am has done PG Diploma in Management from YMCA. We welcome you, ma'am. Please enlighten us with your words of wisdom.
Good morning. How are you guys today? Getting bored with all the presentations? Are you sure? Stock markets are of interest to anyone? That's great. So let's start the presentation. So since you know we're talking about skills here, so first let me introduce myself. My name is Anjali Mukhija. And I think enough has been spoken about me. And you know, right now I'm into a consultancy business of my own, and I have about 20 years of experience in the stock markets. So and wealth advisory, of course. So let's first talk about the skills. You know, we've been the other presenters also have spoken about the skills here. So I would, you know, I have few slides on skills, and with those skills, I would like to share my experiences that how, you know, actually you can implement those skills in real life situations. And from there on, we'll move to the stock markets. So let's begin. Skills for an employee, for a corporate leader. And then again moving on to financial markets and the way forward. In my view, you see there are three skills which are important for an employee as such. The first one being the speed of execution. You know, if someone comes up to you with a problem, the speed with which you provide the resolution to the problem. Now, since there are so many people from telecom business here, and Reliance Jio has just been launched yesterday, and we have been, you know, the entire day yesterday, we've been talking about Reliance Jio only. So, you know, the speed of execution, if you relate it to the telecom market, You can say that, you know, there are players like Bharti, Vodafone, etc., who've been already there. And yesterday we observed that once this Reliance AGM took place and Mr. Mukesh Ambani, he went on to give very lucrative plans to the customers. The shares of Reliance, the shares of Bharti and companies like Idea, they tanked for 10%, tanked to about 10%. So you see, the speed that he is going to provide you, we don't know. Like someone asked a question to the earlier presenter also, that how do you expect that Reliance Jio will perform? Will it be able to deliver? So delivering is the key. And you know, you can get as many as 10 lakh customers on board, but providing them the execution, speed of the execution. One, of course, you have already laid the fiber cables, your connections are going to work, you're going to provide data. But you know, the speed at which the data will come and the speed at which resolution is provided to the customer is the key. And of course, providing new solutions to the customers, providing, if you now, like, you know, Reliance will eventually is giving you a free voice. Now, what does that mean? It means that your dependency on data will increase. He's not charging you for the voice. So, you know, at this point of time, he has created a new solution for the industry. He has said, okay, fine, I'll give you this. And with the result, what has happened in the competition, we all know. Like I just shared with you. Then is the technical expertise. So whatever you're doing, whichever field, HR, operations, risk management, compliance, whichever field you are, you have to be thorough about your field. You have to know the nitty-gritties to the last. You can't just say, you know, I have observed this. I am also a trainer. I'm a certified trainer for continuing professional education with National Institute of Securities Market. So what I've observed with the students is that, you know, they don't go to the nitty-gritty of everything. They will just read it. Jaise bolte na upar upar se karna. So please don't do that. Go into the nitty-gritties of everything. Get your expertise in whatever you are doing. Then is the ownership and the accountability. Now I can tell you 100 examples of people not taking accountability and not taking ownership. Now, you know, be it government. We all know about Kingfisher Airlines. We all know how it got burst. And we all know that recently when they were trying to auction the logo of Kingfisher Airlines, they were not able to do that. They were, so what, you know, how does this relate to the accountability? This relates to accountability in the sense that, you know, while providing loan to Kingfisher Airlines, there was an officer who was sitting in the bank who signed on the document basis on the balance sheet, basis on the Kingfisher Airline performance at that point of time. Now, if there is an accountability or if there was an accountability at that point of time, then that man would not have signed for loan for the logo of Kingfisher Airlines, which has no value today. And at that point of time, when there was someone sitting at the risk management, he approved a loan of 234 crores for the logo of Kingfisher Airlines. Do you think a logo holds that much value? Today, of course, it doesn't hold any good. But even at that point of time, so, you know, accountability is a must. So be it government, be it private, or at your individual levels, accountability plays a very, very important role. Then we'll go to the next section of the slides, which talks about the corporate leader. So apart from this, these skills as a general employee, the leader needs to have some special skills. One, multifold approach. Multifold approach, we all know, from looking at, that means looking at a project or looking at whatever you're doing with different angles. So what could those different angles be? It could be a new business initiative. It could be risk management. It could be, you know, you have to, like someone referred to a global word which says, you know, think global and act local. Then is the flexibility. Flexibility is that you should be able to work in any kind of environment. You have to look at your team. You have to see that, you know, you have to look at the parameters like cost, quality, delivery. Last but not the least, again the go local approach, wherein, you know, the leadership quality is that, you know, since again coming back to the telecom industry, the rural segment, still there's a lot of work which is required to be done in the rural segment of telecom industry. So you can, there'll be a clear distinction between the leader and the laggards. So a global approach of the leader will be a strong parameter in the leadership style. So this comes our money, our finances, which has to be planned in the right way. So you can invest in equities, you can invest in commodities, you can take fixed income instruments. Fixed income instruments are the fixed deposits or the government bonds. The Reserve Bank issues bonds which have a fixed tenure and a fixed rate of interest. Very secure bonds, these are called debt market. There's a debt market, there's an equity market. There's a commodity market, of course there's a real estate, and last but not the least, insurance. So we all tend to, you know, do insurance. At least general insurance, we all know, is mandatory. We get our car, our bike insured, so it is mandatory by the government. We have medical insurance, we have life insurance, so we all are aware of all the products that are currently in the market. Commodities is an asset class. Essentially, what do you think commodities are? Gold, silver, these are bullion commodities. We have agri commodities like tur dal, chana dal, sugar, gur. These are all being traded on the exchange. We have NCDEX and MCX. These are the two major exchanges which are dealing right now in commodities. It gives you a hedge against inflation. And they are, since they are global underlying, gold, silver are governed by the international prices, so they are very difficult to manipulate. And they give you a hedge against the currency fluctuation. Now, how does fund flow in the market? Now, if you look at the slide, you'll see that there are people who are spenders, and there are people who are actually looking. There are borrowers and there are lenders. So who are the lenders? The banks primarily, or the NBFCs. And who are the last users? Are us. We are only giving money at one place, and we are taking loans, and we are taking it back in some form or the other by loans, etc. So this is how, through direct finance and through indirect finance, fund is moving in the industry. Now, if we broadly look at the financial system, it contains three intermediaries it has. One is the financial intermediaries, financial markets, and the financial assets. Financial intermediaries would essentially be banks, NBFCs, mutual funds, and insurance organization. Even in case of mutual fund, we lend our funds to the fund manager who invests it in the market. So even if you look at the mutual funds, the funds are directly or indirectly going into the markets, whether it is the money market or it is the equity market. Like I shared with you this, that the investors, they pool in money, give it to the fund manager who invests it in the market and generates a return, and the return eventually is passed back to the investors. So this is how the finances move in the industry. Again, financial markets are of two types, money market and the secondary market, capital markets. We all have heard about National Stock Exchange and Bombay Stock Exchange. Now, National Stock Exchange is a pioneer in the electronic trading. Prior to National Stock Exchange was made in 1994. Now, prior to 1994, there was floor trading at Bombay Stock Exchange or Delhi Stock Exchange. Now, what is essentially, what does a floor trading means? You know, there used to be people, there used to be a big place, a big round place, wherein people used to be like shouting the prices. The rates were manipulated and the investors, they never used to go to that ring. It was kind of a ring and the investors never used to go to the ring. So the brokers used to manipulate the investors. And how did they used to do that? When you wanted to buy something, they'll give you at a X price, and you want to sell something, they'll give you at a Y price, thereby making a lot of money for themselves. And there was no transparency. You could not see what is the offer. There was no ask bid rate available. Like today, I have my office in my phone. Now, how is that possible? That's possible because I can see the prices, there is transparency, there is an online trading available. Even in case of other things, your daily routines, there are a lot of e-commerce websites we know. So you actually know, get to know the real price. So consumer is the king today. Now coming back to the markets, there are the buyers of securities. There's someone who buys, there's someone who sells. The one who buys has a view on the stock market. He feels that this particular stock is good, or the balance sheet is good, or the company's future prospects are good. So he buys. And there's someone else on the other side who sells. And why would someone sell? Because he has a different view. Stock market works because there are two people who have different views. There's someone who's a seller and he is of the opinion that this stock is not going to do well now, so I should be exiting out of the stock. There are sellers, there are buyers, there are intermediaries. Who are these intermediaries? The intermediaries are the trading members, the brokers, the stock brokers. They bring together buyers and sellers, and that's how the transactions happen. Then there are regulators who regulates the participants. And who are the regulators? We all know SEBI is a main regulator. Let's understand, we all keep hearing these terms in the stock market, that there are two sections of the market. One is of course the capital market, other one is the derivatives market. So let's give a quick look at what is the difference between the capital markets and the derivatives market. There are shares, there are debentures, warrants, mutual funds, and of course the exchange trading, traded funds. And derivatives market is entirely a speculative market. It derives its value from the underlying. When we say an underlying, it means that, you know, there is a stock in the cash market which from where it is deriving the value. In currency market also, whatever is the international market, the currency derivatives is also governed by the same rule. There are index futures, there are stock futures, stock options, there is currency derivatives already shared, and of course there are commodity derivatives. This is a brief of what is the current landscape, the financial landscape. Right on top, of course, is the Ministry of Finance, which has vested powers in SEBI. SEBI has further exchanges and the DMAT. This NSDL and CDSL is the National Depository Services Limited and Central Depository Services Limited. And then we have members, brokers, depository participants, sub-brokers and their authorized representatives. And last but not the least is the investors, through whom the actual trading or the actual movement of funds takes place. Now, way back when I started my career with NSE, we all had physical shares. Now, I really don't know whether you have got an opportunity to see the physical share. It was a paper share and it had the certificate number, the DNR's number and the folio number. The folio number used to be a unique number through which you identify the investor. Now, what used to happen was that the company itself used to generate fake forged shares, take loan on those fake forged shares, and actually there used to be a duplicacy of shares in the market. It was very difficult to identify which are the fake shares, which are the correct shares. That at that point of time, we used to, the clearing used to take place. Clearing, by clearing, I mean that, you know, the settlement cycles were 7 days. So the settlements used to start from Wednesday and end on Tuesdays. So these 7 days, you could keep buying and selling, and there was no obligation generated. By obligation generated, I mean that you didn't have to essentially settle the shares. Now, stock market, as we all know about, funds and shares. So when the clearing used to take place after 7 days, there used to be these big bunches of physical shares which used to come. Few of them were torn, few of them were fake. So there were a lot of problems till NSDL and CDSL came up with the DMAT shares. Now, when we talk of DMAT shares, now why I'm talking about all this today is because in our day-to-day life, we tend to hear all those words, but we don't understand what is the meaning of these words. So I thought this is a good opportunity to actually let you know what does these words mean in our day-to-day life. So when we talk of a DMAT shares, it merely means that it's just like a bank account. You go and deposit your 100 rupees in the bank, your passbook says you have 100 rupees, right? Similarly, if you have 100 shares of, say, Tata Motors, you're in DMAT account, your account shows you have 100 shares of Tata Motors in DMAT mode. So in DMAT mode, basically, it gives you the convenience of moving the shares from one person to another, or from one person to the stock market in case you've sold the share. And similarly, it also gives you a convenience to take loan on the share. So if you pledge the share and take a loan, that facility is also available in electronic mode. So like I was sharing with you, so physical shares had all these problems. So overnight, you know, our people in the clearing house used to sit, sort out those shares, because there were people who had sold the shares, there were people who had bought the shares. So people who had sold the shares would actually deliver the shares to the clearing house, and who had bought the shares would get the delivery of the stock. So we, things have become much easier once we move to the electronic shares, electronic fund. Now the settlement is a one-day settlement. Imagine the settlement from 7 days to one-day settlement. That means whatever happens today has to be settled in another 2 days, next 2 days. So the settlement cycles have become shorter. We have come into an electronic mode, into a digital mode. So let's look at SEBI now. Now, you know, what are the functions of SEBI? We keep reading in papers about SEBI. SEBI is the Securities and Exchange Board of India. It has powers to regulate the securities market. It promotes the development of securities. It protects the investors. It regulates, brings out policies, guidelines, and the powers are vested through SEBI Act and the SCRA, which is the Securities and Contract Regulations Act. It controls manipulation, price rigging. We all hear then now and again that, you know, some scam happened. Now, you know, off late, we don't hear much about the scams. So it basically, SEBI provides investors with, you know, it gives confidence of sharing, confidence of buying shares in the market. it gives you the confidence that yes, whatever I'm doing today, with whatever limited knowledge I have, at least there won't be someone on the other side who's doing a scam in the market. So it, you know, it prevents manipulation, price rigging, and other regulatory breaches. It prohibits fraudulent and unfair trade practices. It initiates special investigations. It has special powers. It regulates the acquisition and shares and takeovers. So, if suppose there is a merger or an acquisition, everything has to be, you know, taken prior permission from SEBI, and only then that can happen, especially for listed companies. Now, also, we get to hear a lot about IPO. So, how many of you have heard about IPO? Oh, that's great. So, which is the recent IPO that you guys invested in? Can't hear. RBL, right? Okay. RBL, Dr. Lal PathLab. We get to hear so many, you know, companies who are coming up with IPO. So, essentially, what does an IPO mean? Initial public offering, that's correct. And what is the relation between an initial public offering and a stock exchange? So this just shows you that initial public offering is a new offering. It's a direct, you know, a company is asking you for money. In simple terms, IPO means that the company comes and asks you for money. Like you bought RBL shares. So what did they give you? They gave you shares and you gave them money. So it's a new type of security. It is a direct investment, and also it provides you an opportunity to enter the stock markets. What are the functions of stock exchange? It gives you an access between the savings and investment. Like I started my presentation with saying that, you know, you save and then you invest. It's a marketplace for sale and purchase of securities, and it provides a continuous price formulation. Now, how does it happen? How does a continuous price formation happens? Because there are people on one side who are bidding to buy, and on other side they're bidding to sell. So there, the price, wherever the price matches, the trade takes place. So this is how stock exchanges work, and they provide a continuous price formation. A brief about the transaction process. Like I told you, there are two things in the stock market: funds and shares. Stock exchanges, they have their clearing corporation through which the actual clearing, the settlement of the trades takes place. The depositories for shares, the clearing banks for funds, and the stock brokers. Stock brokers are the intermediaries. Now we all know that Aadhaar is now being linked to all the investments. Now, how does this help? Aadhaar brings in a lot of money into the financial market. Why? Because, you know, the KYC norms are now decentralized. Now, how does this KYC thing work? We all have heard about KYC. Whenever you go to a bank, you go to a financial intermediaries, he asks you, aapka KYC hua hai kya? So, KYC is know your customer, and it basically, now everyone will have one KYC. So whichever financial intermediaries or whichever financial market you go into, you will only be using that KYC. That means you'll not be required to give your documents again and again. So once you get your KYC registered with your voter card, your passport, your whatever government document that refers to, and your PAN card, so you have one KYC which you can use with your bank, you can use with your mutual funds, you can use with your equity market, commodity market, or wherever you wish to trade, or you put your money, wherever you want to put your money. Now, there are key regulatory agencies, KRAs, which keep your documents with them, and that documents are readily available to anyone who you are enrolling with. Then there is an order placement, there is a risk management, there is an order matching. Like I told you, the order will match only if the prices match and the trades takes place. And there is a clearing and settlement which happens on a T+2 day. That means if the trade happens on a Monday, then Wednesday it has to be cleared. The shares and funds will move. Now, how technology is a boon to the market? Because the stock market is using state-of-the-art information technology. It is a screen-based trading. The settlement cycles, like I shared with you, from 7 days have reduced to 1 day, a T+2 settlement. There is a dematerialization and electronic transfer of securities. The risk management systems are robust. The clearing corporation, they take the counterparty risk. They ensure that the trades, whatever are done, are settled on a second day. And they have intensive use of information technology. The SEBI initially mandated that the contract note has to be sent within 24 hours of the trade. A contract note is a legal document. Whatever trades happen on the exchange, they are substantiated by the contract note. So SEBI mandated that all the contract notes are required to be sent within 24 hours to the customer. Now, how would that happen? If someone sitting in Chennai trades on the trading online trading platform and the market intermediaries, which is a stockbroker or a trading member, is in Delhi. So how do you expect the contract note will reach Chennai through courier? It was just impossible. So electronic contract notes were introduced, which is being sent even currently to the customers, and it just takes a click to send the contract notes. It's a legal document and it is valid for all the transactions that is done on the exchange. All the company related information, suppose you want to invest in a company, the balance sheets, the profit loss statements, everything today is available online. The confirmation is sent to the investors through the stock exchange, through the members. There is mobile trading, there is internet trading. So me sitting here today, if I want to trade, I can do that. There is an online lodging of investor grievance. They have, you know, there are investor grievance redressal committees which are being made with the stock exchanges. And there is an arbitration mechanism with every stock exchange. So if you are aggrieved and you don't know where to go, there is enough opportunity for you at the stock exchange wherein you can go, and if there is someone who has done a fraud with you, you can complain against that particular person for stock market trading. There is arbitration mechanism available wherein a case is required to be settled within 3 months. Also, there is a trade verification website on the stock exchange. So at the end of the day, if you want to verify that yes, this trade has been done by me or not, you can do that. So these are confidence building measures which have been taken by SEBI and the stock exchange, which encourage people like you and me to actually trade in the stock market. And it gives us, you know, बोलते हैं ना कि मन को सहारा है कि हाँ कोई है, अगर कुछ प्रॉब्लम होगी तो देख लेगा. नाउ वी ऑल नो दैट देर इज लॉट ऑफ ब्लैक मनी विच इज बीइंग सर्कुलेटेड इन द मार्केट. फॉर दैट देर आर PMLA रेगुलेशन विच टॉक्स अबाउट प्रिवेंशन ऑफ मनी लॉन्डरिंग एक्ट. नाउ दिस पर्टिकुलर एक्ट केम इन 2002 एंड इट टॉक्स अबाउट यू नो दैट एवरी कॉरपोरेट, be it a stockbroker or be it a company, are required to appoint a principal officer. Now, what is this principal officer's job? He has to see that there is no money laundering in the company. He has to monitor the transactions. He has to inform the Financial Intelligence Unit, FIU, of the government by all financial intermediaries. So typically, if you look at how would a PMLA transaction take place? A PMLA transaction would take place that, you know, the money would come in someone's hand, would actually, it integrates into the financial system. Now, how does this integrate into the financial system? You'll buy things like luxury assets, financial investments, industrial investments. With that money, you'll go into the real estate sector. You will transfer on the bank on account of some company X, which will make a wire transfer to some international company, international bank. From international bank, it will come as a loan to the company Y. And company Y will again make a payment and false invoice to the company X. So this is how a typical PMLA or a money laundering would happen. So to prevent this, lot of initiatives are being taken by the government. All right, moving forward. I'm sure by looking at this slide, you all be able to make out that I'm a big fan of Mr. Modi. And I share his vision here of Digital India. So what are the three key ideas of Digital India? Of course, the creation of digital infrastructure and electronic manufacturing in India. So you can see that, you know, manufacturing is also Make in India. We all know about the initiative. Delivery of all government services electronically, e-governance. So down the line, your driving licenses or the license, you know, the industries which require licensing, everything is going to be electronic. Digital empowerment of Indian citizens. Now, how does this happen? This happens in rural areas. You have to ensure in metros, you know, there's no problem. We all are digitally equipped. We all know how to use the digital equipments. But if you go to rural areas, I'll share my experience with you. I'm a pure Delhiite. I was born and brought up in Delhi. But I got married to someone who is from a town called Sri Ganganagar on the, this is on the border, Pakistan border. I've been visiting this place for about 20 years now. I don't see much of a change there, be it infrastructure, be it, you know, the way the people think and the way the people operate. I don't see much of a change, except that the, you know, kids there, the upcoming, the youth like you, they have moved out of the place and they've gone to other places to work or, you know, to do business, etc. But as a town, I don't see much changes there. Now, why do you think that has happened? Anyone would like to share this? Why do you think that has happened? Why is there that there's no development in a place like maybe Bikaner or maybe place like, you know, Sri Ganganagar? Sorry? Yeah, there are less resources. There's only one engineering college. There's only one medical college. And how many people do you think can get into one engineering college who has a limited seat of maybe 100 or a 200 capacity? So people necessarily have to move out and only then get admissions elsewhere, or they have to, even for work, they're working, you know, there's a person in our family working in Bangalore. So she has to, poor thing, she has to first come from that place to Delhi, and from Delhi to Bangalore, and from Bangalore to her workplace. If she would have got the same facilities in that particular area, do you think she would have moved out? Or he or she would have moved out? So that's what the, you know, empowerment is all about. These are the tools. A digital identity. A digital identity today is the Aadhaar card. Everything is being linked. Even the gas subsidies and the MNREGA, which is, you know, given to people who are below poverty line, even that is being linked to the Aadhaar card. Recently, I was watching CNBC, and they were showing me that in Rajasthan, they have, now they've given machines to all the ration shops there. So the person, what used to happen was the government used to allocate ration to for people, and that never used to reach the poor. So now they've given these machines to the rationing shops, and whoever is the eligible holder has to have an Aadhaar card. And the Aadhaar card, you all know, has our thumbprint. So that thumbprint has to be matched, and only then the ration will be allotted to the person. So it is an initiative which ensures that the poor gets the benefit. We all know about JNK. We all know that what is happening these days in Kashmir. We are all aware. So why do you think this has happened? Why do you think the youth of Kashmir is now at such a desperate level that they are throwing stones at our police officers. Because the money that has been going to JNK, and you know, if you look at the statistics, a lot of money has been going to JNK. Now, this money, it has never reached the poor. So, the poor is becoming poorer. And the entire money, you know, is not reaching to the last person. So how do you think we will ensure that the facilities or whatever is, you know, being allotted by the government for the poor, it reaches the last person, the person at the base level? I think Aadhaar is the link. Bank account for direct transfer benefit, we all know under Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, this was done, wherein all accounts were opened by the poor and they were asked to, you know, give their details and everything, and that was again linked to Aadhaar, so that the benefits of, you know, insurance, everybody was given a 2 lakh insurance, the poor were given a 2 lakh insurance, the insurance and everything reaches to the last person. A mobile phone for universal access, universal services, universal access to all services. So what was happening was, in Rajasthan, like I shared with you, the rationing shops were given the electronic gadget, you know, which could track the thumbprint. Now for a person whose thumbprint was not matched, they were asked a mobile number, and on that particular registered mobile number they were sent a password, and through that password they were able to allocate the ration, which is, I think, commendable. So if that can happen in a state like Rajasthan, I'm sure the entire India can duplicate that. Make in India program. Now the recent news is that, and I'm glad to share this, and I would expect a clap from every one of you. India has ranked the 35th among the 160 countries in World Bank Logistic Performance Index. Now, what does this index mean? This Logistic Performance Index, what we are talking about, LPI, is basically an index which shows our performance in our competitiveness in manufacturing and trade. That acts as the growth driver of Make in India program. So the initiatives which have been taken by the government are slowly, you know, showing its colors. We all know FDI, direct investment, foreign direct investments. We have received $55.46 billion of investment in the fixed deposit, and it is because that defense sector has now 100% FDI. We all know aviation sector, defense sector, and now in even food processing. So food processing also has 100% FDI. Because of this, lot of funds are moving into India. So looking for a better India, here I end my presentation with Mr. Modi's vision. Earlier it was believed that force indicates power. Now power must come through strength of ideas and effective dialogues. Thank you. This is for Mr. Modi.
Thank you, ma'am. Now the house is open for questions.
Hello. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
My name is Aditya Giri and I'm from BITM marketing batch. Question is, IPO helps a company to raise funds from public, then why Indian startups like Ola, Flipkart and all are not opting for IPOs? Means, what are the fear in their minds?
For bringing an IPO, there are certain guidelines which are required to be followed as per SEBI. So Ola and Flipkart, they do not fall into that category, that's why. Otherwise, who doesn't want money from public? Tomorrow, I may also raise a company and I say I want money from public. But there are certain policies, certain guidelines which have to be followed. And Ola and Flipkart, they do not have such, they do not, you know, fall into that particular category wherein they can bring in an IPO. Yeah?
Very good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Right. That's great. All right, that's a valid question. So let's first understand, you know, why women don't invest in commodities. Way back in 1995, when I joined the National Stock Exchange, I used to visit the trading members' office. There was not even a single woman there. And people used to look at me like, मैडम स्टॉक मार्केट में तो औरतें नहीं होती, आप कहाँ से आ गए. सो यू नो यू कांट चेंज द माइंड सेट. ऑफकोर्स इट इज स्लोली चेंजिंग. सो वन इज माइंड सेट ऑफकोर्स, एंड द वे वी आर ब्रॉट अप इज दैट इवन आई रिमेंबर टुडे माई मदर वुड ऑल्सो टेल मी के इफ यू हैव स्पेयर मनी वाई डोंट यू गो एंड बाय गोल्ड. वी वर बाइंग अ फ्लैट, इंसिडेंटली दिस वॉज ईयर्स बैक, अबाउट 20 ईयर्स बैक. And I told my mom, "Mom, see, we are short of money. Let me sell my gold and take the money and give it in the flat." She says, "No, no, sone ko haath mat lagana." So I said, "Ye kiske liye hai?" She said, "Rainy days ke liye." So I said, "Yahi to rainy day hai mera. Mujhe chahiye paise." She says, "No, no, tumhare bachche honge, bachchon ke bachche honge, unko chahiye hoga." So it's the mindset. That's the way we are brought up. That's one thing. Another thing is knowledge. People don't have knowledge. They don't understand what commodities market is all about. It is very difficult for them to convince that yahan pe bhi jo aap kaam karoge aapko uski delivery milegi, sona milega. To ek wo baat point hai ki knowledge ka jo, because like I shared with you, small places they don't have knowledge. I have done various investor seminars also with SEBI. And what we observed was that people were, you know, people were not happy investing in equities. They did not have the confidence to invest. They always had ki nahi nahi mujhe nahi pata, mujhe aata nahi hai ye sab. So if you give them proper knowledge, I'm sure that they will invest. And now that the lot size has come down, you can even buy 10 grams gold. So if they understand, earlier the lot sizes were too much, you could get 1 kg gold. So who would invest in 1 kg gold? No one, you know, wants to keep 1 kg gold at home or in the lockers. So absence of knowledge is also one point, which is very, very important. So if you actually, you know, make them understand what this market is all about and how safe is it to invest in the market, I'm sure, be it men or women, everyone will come and invest.
Rafu ma'am,
I have answered your
question. This is going to be the last question.
Rafu ma'am, my name is Prakhar Jivargi. I'm from marketing batch BIMM. Ma'am, my question is how FII and DII determine the direction of the market, and what's your outlook towards the market in the near term?
Right. Okay. Now, how FIIs and DIIs they invest? Of course, they invest on the balance sheet. They would look at the company's prospects. They would study the balance sheet. They would see that what is the future prospects of the company, what are the future prospects, how the company is, you know, going on the projects, who is managing the company. That is also very important. Which are the people, who are the directors on board. So they study the company thoroughly, and on that basis only they invest, be it FII or DII. Because see, no one wants ke main aaj 100 rupees lagaun to kal mujhe 100 bhi wapas na mile. Even you would not want that. Who wants that? So they do a thorough study of the company, and on the basis of the projects and the government policies, there are majorly three things, you know, your balance sheet, that is the profit and loss, your future projects, your management people, who are the ones who are handling. So these are the three broad parameters on which they decide which company to buy or which company to sell. And the second part of the question, sorry?
Yeah. For your outlook in the near term for the market?
Well, you know, I expect market to do very well because the economy is doing very well. We are at a 7.8 GDP. So I expect the markets to do very well with companies, you know, with companies now going international, say a TCS, or if you look at HCL, they have brilliant projects. Even, you know, a company like DLF is doing a lot of things now. So, you know, if you look at the innovations and the future prospects of the company, I see India going far ahead from where we are today.
Effect of global market on Indian market?
Effect of global market, of course, is there. But you see, the impact of global market is very limited, to the extent that it just comes and goes for a day or two. But ultimately, it is the domestic that matters. There are certain there's a certain industry which depends on the international market. So that particular industry gets affected. But in a short term, you know, you've also observed ki Nasdaq gira, to Nifty bhi gira, ya Sensex bhi gira. Lekin wo short term ke liye hota hai, but ultimately domestic is the one that comes into picture. And domestically, I think we are doing very good. Unless, you know, government changes its policies or there is something drastic that happens, like Trump comes as a president, we all know. So that could make an effect on the market. Thank you. Anything else?
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your immense knowledge about the financial market. Today, we learn about the different skills required for employees and the corporate leaders. For example, speed, technical expertise, ownership and accountability, etc. We learned about the financial planning, how and where to invest in our savings. We also learned about the commodities and the fund flow in the financial market. We learned about the mutual fund operations and security markets, stock markets landscape in India, relationship between IPO and stock exchange, and lastly, Digital India program and Make in India program. Thank you, ma'am. We look forward for many more such interactions on and off the campus.
May I now request Dr. G. Gopal Krishnan, Director, BIM HRD, to present a memento to Mrs. Anjali Mukhija.
Thank you, sir.